you. I'm just looking at the organizer to thank them. Right. Oh, yes. Yeah. So thank you, Manoj, and thank you, Professor Innocent Shastri, for giving me this opportunity to visit another campus of TIFR. I am also part of TIFR, but I have never been here. So it's good to be here. Thank you. All right. Topic of my lecture is, in some sense, what may be called branching laws for representations of classical groups. But maybe just to begin the discussion, the question that I will be discussing would be that you have a group G containing a subgroup H, and the question of interest is classify irreducible representations of G always over complex numbers over C, which have H. So one could be more precise about this, and one could try to understand the multiplicity of the trivial representation. So this is kind of a very general question. One may say that this is a particular, one may say, this is a particular case of a more general question which is to understand all representations in a given representation of G. So which is to understand pi restricted to H. This is what is called a branching law. Branching laws tell you how does a representation of a group decompose when you restrict to a subgroup. But you know, this question about, this more general question in fact is a particular case of the previous one by embedding the group H inside G cross H. So a general representation here is pi 1 cross pi 2, pi 1 external tensor product pi 2, and the multiplicity of the trivial representation of H now will determine how many times pi 2 appears in pi 1 dual. So in some sense, this question contains this question, but for a slightly different group. Okay, this question has been of interest, I think, in many contexts. I believe people in this conference and workshop are more used to finite group theory. So this is what I will speak about. My own background comes from PRD groups and automorphic forms, but that subject indeed draws a lot of inspiration from finite group theory. So in some sense, although I am an outsider to finite group theory, but a close neighbor. And therefore, concepts which are useful for finite group theory often are imitated in the context of automorphic forms. And one such theorem, which is quite beautiful, I think to my taste, it's one of models of theorems to be proved. So this is about GLN. So yeah, this is a theorem due to Klitschko. It's an old theorem which says that if you look at induction, okay, so maybe I will introduce a little bit of notation. So we have this group, GLNFQ, and inside this, we will look at the subgroup, which is SP2M of FQ. And then we will look at this. This would be zeros. This would be stars. And this is the unipotent group, stars. Yeah? So this is a subgroup of GLNFQ. And call this subgroup HM. Is this subgroup. So this is defined for all integers M such that 2M is less than equal to M. Right? For so HMs are defined for all twice M less than equal to N. And it comes equipped with a character. So fix psi naught to be a non-trivial character, trivial character of FQ C star psi naught. Yeah? And then you define this character psi m on HM by looking at these entries, and I will randomly call them A1, AD. The entry just above the diagonal, right? And psi m of x is equal to psi naught of A1 plus AD. Right. So I will then state this theorem of Klitschko. Theorem of Klitschko says that you look at this induction from HM to GLNFQ of this character psi m, and you look at the direct sum of this for 2m less than equal to n. So this is equal to sum of all irreducible representations of GLNFQ with multiplicity 1. So this is what is called a model. It's a role model, but it's also called a model of a representation. So model is trying to find subgroups from which you induce. You get representations which appear with multiplicity 1, and then try to induce such similar looking representations so that you can fill up all the irreducible representations of a group with multiplicity 1. So indeed. So this theorem is valid for GLN, and forms of this theorem are also true for PRD groups and automorphic forms. But this theorem for finite field came first. And in some sense, GLN is the simplest of all groups that we know. And unfortunately, a theorem of this kind does not hold for maybe any other. My talk will be about one special case of this theorem that I have recently been considering for unitary groups. But before I do that, let me draw a corollary of this theorem, which is that, so I will define this term soon, a cuspidal representation of GL2NFQ does not have a symplectic model. Symplectic model. So symplectic model means representations of GL2n FQ which are realized on functions on GL2n upon SP2n. So, a representation I of GL2n FQ is said to have symplectic model. If pi is contained inside induction from SP2n FQ to GL2n FQ of the trivial simplicity, which is equivalent to say by Frobenius reciprocity that pi does not have a fixed vector for SP2n FQ, right? So, i.e., I SP 2N FQ equals 0. So, because it is a direct sum of representations, this is the case. Okay, so I need to give an argument, and I promise that I will define a cuspidal representation, although I have the feeling that maybe one of the courses may have done it, but in any case, I don't mind defining. So I need to give a proof, and the proof consists of saying that cuspidal representations of GL2n FQ have a Whittaker model. This is a very common word, so you might as well see this word. I have a Whittaker model. I.e., it appears in induction from the unipotent group N to GL2n FQ of psi 2n. So I have defined this character psi m. In the extreme case, when there is no m, m equals 0, it will be only the unipotent group. And if you do this character, this is one of the most famous of all models, and it's called Gelfand-Graev model. Gelfand-Graev. So a cuspidal representation appears there. And because of multiplicity 1, it cannot appear in any other piece. And therefore, it cannot appear with a symplectic part. And therefore, it cannot have a symplectic model. So if a representation has a Gelfand-Graev model, it cannot have a symplectic model. So, well, all right. Yeah, good. Right. Although I am a bit okay. Let's call it psi n. Although let's call it psi 2n to be the character on the unipotent radical of the upper triangular matrices, which takes it to the sum of just off diagonal entries, yeah? Right. Okay. So what I want to do in my lecture today is, as I said, there is no analog of this theorem for other groups. But for unitary group, I will make a theorem which is like this corollary. But before that, I want to say a few words about cuspidal representations. Sorry. N is the unipotent group of the GL2n FQ, which is the group of unipotent upper triangular matrices. Psi 0? Correct. That looks better. You
because, you know, N somehow seemed neither, okay, this is much better. But I hope, right, psi 0. But psi 0 has been already taken up by some other notation, so it may confuse. So why not I just define this character psi 0 again, psi 0, and now I can do it more clearly, 1, 2, plus so on, xn minus 1, n is equal to this psi 0 of x is equal to psi 0. Right? Okay. So I want to say a few words about cuspidal representations. So I believe there have been courses here on representations. No, they have not been. Okay. So it is okay for me to remind you on this. In any case, it is okay to see it again. So what happens in the representation theory of groups? Induction is one of the most important ways to construct representations of a group from representations of the subgroups. For a general group, there are many groups, many subgroups, and many representations of the subgroups, and this operation is somehow not so systematic. But for finite groups of Lie type, there is a much better induction called parabolic induction or Harishchandra induction, which is much, much better. And what one does is to build up representations of a group from representations of Levy subgroups in a very nice and uniform way. And so for any group G, there is a notion of a parabolic P, and there is a notion of Levy decomposition for such a parabolic. And this M is a quotient group. So this has a surjection onto M. And therefore, if M operates on some representation pi, then P operates on pi with trivial action of N. So you can do induction of pi from P to G. This is called parabolic induction. Yeah, and as I said, this induction is much better than the usual inductions. So there are two aspects to this induction. It is being done from a nice class of subgroups, and the representations on that subgroup are also of a certain kind. They are trivial on N, right? So these are called, this is called parabolic induction, and these are called parabolically induced representations, and representations of G, which arise as a sub-representation of one of these for P not equal to G. I mean, you must exclude the parabolic, which is the whole group, because then any representation will arise. Irreducible representations of G, which arise as a sub-representation of one of these for P not equal to G. Then such representations are called principal series. And representations which are not a principal series, are called cuspidal. So for any finite group of Lie type, there is a notion of a cuspidal representation. And somehow this notion is also important because it allows you to construct all representation of a group from cuspidal representations of Lie subgroup. So there is a small lemma which is to be proved. And this may be called Harishchandra philosophy of cusp forms. Which is only a small lemma here, which says that any irreversible representation of G arises from parabolic induction. Cuspidal representation on its Lie subgroup. P not equal to G. P equals trivial is not a parabolic. P not equal to G. You know, trivial group is not a parabolic. But P equals G is a parabolic, and you should avoid that. No, P equals G means that then you are allowing all representations of G. So you don't want to allow all, you want to allow proper intersections. All right. So somehow, because of this lemma, the representation theory of finite groups of Lie type, and there are similar lemmas for real and PRD groups, they allow one to say that the cusp forms on all Lie groups are the building blocks of all representations. If you understand cuspidal representations, then you understand in some terms all. They are the building blocks. And therefore, it is often the main problem to understand what are the cuspidal representations and what are their properties. Right. So, to continue. It means I have so much time left. I was a little worried. I saw some time ago and 16 minutes left, right. So far, so good. So the theorem that I wish to prove is something which I have recently done with one of my students, Sarah DeJoles. As I said, my own interests are automorphic forms and PRD groups. But we will state this theorem only for finite groups, in which case it is a known theorem. So the theorem says that cuspidal representations of a unitary group of U to N So all the terms have been defined. Maybe what needs to be first said is that symplectic groups which are contained inside GL2N are also contained inside unitary groups. That needs to be said. So for that, everyone knows what are unitary groups. They are defined by some Hermitian form, and they are isometric group of a Hermitian form. So UNFQ is defined to be G belongs to GL2N of FQ square, such that G transpose G, G transpose bar, H, right, where H is a Hermitian form. But among Hermitian, it's traditional to define unitary groups by Hermitian form, but you can also define them using skew Hermitian. Because by multiplication by root D, you can change a Hermitian form into a skew Hermitian form, where root D is, right. So suppose that D belongs to FQ star, but not to its squares. Its square, so that FQ root D is FQ square. Yeah? Maybe you will worry about characteristic 2, but let us not worry about it. And as I said, that Hermitian forms, if you multiply by root D, they go from Hermitian to skew Hermitian. Because to say that something is a Hermitian form means that H transpose bar is equal to H. And if you multiply by root D, the only difference is that it will become minus sign, and therefore you pick up a minus sign. Right? But you know, whether you have H or root D times H, this group is the same. Unitary groups can be defined by Hermitian or a skew Hermitian form. And now it is clear that symplectic group is contained inside a unitary group, which is by saying that symplectic group is defined by a skew symmetric matrix over FQ. Think of the same skew symmetric matrix over FQ square. Then it becomes skew Hermitian. Right? So a skew symmetric matrix, over FQ is skew Hermitian over FQ square. Because there is no Galois action, so H transpose bar is just H transpose, and it is skew symmetric, so it is skew. Right? So therefore, we need to observe that SP2 and FQ is contained inside. All right, so in some sense, what we need to do is that, of course, the proof will be by some kind of a contradiction, that it cannot be cuspidal and symplectic at the same time. So to say that it is symplectic means that it has a vector which is fixed by SP2NFQ. And to say that it is cuspidal is equivalent to saying by Frobenius reciprocity that it does not have a fixed vector by unipotent radical of a parabola. So what you need to prove is that this cannot happen together. So proof. We need to prove that if pi sp 2n fq is non-zero, then pi n is also non-zero for some unipotent radical of a parabolic . This is what we need to prove. So, of course, if by some chance, if there was a unipotent radical of the bigger group contained inside the smaller group, then of course there would be no issue. Because there is a fixed vector under this, and therefore there is a fixed vector under all its subgroups. And if there is a unipotent radical which is already contained there, then of course this would become totally obvious. So I'm sure you realize that it is not so simple. Right, so there is some work to be done here. And, right, so I think we have to somehow deal with So in some sense, the idea of the proof is that although it is too much to expect that there is a unipotent radical contained inside symplectic, unipotent radical of the bigger group contained inside the symplectic group, but there might be a unipotent radical which is somehow not quite contained, but it captures much of that unipotent subgroup is in some sense contained inside SP2N. So you will get some mileage. So we want to use that mileage in some ways. And somehow the rest needs to be done with some cleverness. Yeah? All right. So we need to create that N somehow. So we begin with, maybe instead of bothering you with unitary groups, maybe I will give simpler notationally GL2N. Yeah, so idea of the proof. Proof for this pair instead of unitary groups, yeah? So, there is a notion of what is called a Klingen parabolic. So Klingen parabolic inside symplectic group is the subgroup of the symplectic group which stabilizes a line. Stabilizers of lines are typically parabolics, and this is called a Klingen parabolic, and its structure is the following. It looks like this. Some of people who do matrix groups, they like to show matrices. So it looks like this. This looks like SP2N minus 2F, and so since I'm talking about parabolic, it will have this stars, these zeros, this zero. And then there are this stars. Right? And corresponding parabolic. GL to NFQ also has a similar structure. Yeah. So, which means that for the Klingon parabolic in SP2N, this middle block is SP2N minus 2. And then there are some entries there. For GL2N, this middle block is GL2N minus 2. And then there are stars. But those stars are slightly different for symplectic than for general linear group. For general linear group, these stars are arbitrary. But for the symplectic group, these stars are not arbitrary. So to say, this star is transpose of this star in some sense. Yeah? This star and this star are transpose of each other. This star is arbitrary. This is one by one matrix. So what we are given is that you have a representation of SP2N, which has a fixed vector for, we have a representation of GL2N, which has a fixed vector for SP2N, and therefore it certainly has a fixed vector for the unipotent radical of the symplectic group. But this unipotent radical is much smaller than the unipotent radical of GL2N. So we need to do some work to reach there. So these unipotent groups are slightly non-abelian. They are they are the next groups to abelian groups, what are called Heisenberg groups. And the nice thing is that if you denote the unipotent radical of, let's call it Q, this is the parabolic for symplectic group. This is SP2N minus 2 times, let's call it NS, and let's call this P to be GL of 2N minus 2 NG. Right? The parabolic, this is what is called the Levy decomposition. Yeah? I have somehow forgotten this star, which doesn't play much of a role. It will be a bit of a notation here, but let's not worry because we are worrying more about the unipotent radicals. So the point is that NG upon NS is a normal subgroup inside NG, and this group is isomorphic to F raised to power 2N minus 2 as a module for SP2N-2. The symplectic group SP2N-2 has a standard representation on 2N-2 dimensional vector space over your field. Standard representation. So what happens is that you have a representation pi. You look at pi NS. Pi NS becomes a module for that subgroup of the bigger group which normalizes NS. That's a generality, is a module for that subgroup of G. Which normalizes NS. G is the GL2N. NS is the unipotent radical of the symplectic group. And we are looking at the normalizer of the unipotent radical of the symplectic group inside the bigger group. So this normalizer, of course, will contain this Levy group. Because this Levy group certainly normalizes NS. And this contains NG. Because somehow, as I said already here, that NS sits as a normal subgroup of NG. So what happens is that pi ns is a module, and therefore what we get is that pi ns is a module for sp 2n minus 2 semi-direct product with f 2n minus 2. This group is ng by ns. Somehow the aim is, you know, to construct the trivial character of this group, ng. That's the aim. And somehow what we are given is that it has a fixed vector for sp2n minus 2. We want to somehow trade off fixed vectors for this by a fixed vector of that. So the important observation here is that this is a context of what is called semi-direct product with an abelian normal subgroup. And that is one of the simplest situations for representation theory. If you have H semi-direct product A, a situation of this kind, then what there is something called Clifford theory. It describes you irreducible representations of a semi-direct product, especially when the normal subgroup is abelian. And so let me just say Clifford theory. Clifford theory. So that describes every irreducible representation of such a semi-direct product as induction from H psi times A of a character psi used to H times. Where psi is a particular character of A. So one important observation along the way is that the character group of F to the power 2n minus 2 can be identified to F2 to the power n minus 2. For any finite field FQ, character group of FQ is isomorphic to FQ, right? So the character group of FQ to the power 2n minus 2 is also isomorphic to FQ to the power 2n minus 2, and the action of this symplectic group on the character group can be identified to this natural representation. And one important observation is that the action of the symplectic group, the standard representation of the symplectic group, has only two orbits. One is the zero vector and one is non-zero vector. This is what may be called Witt's theorem, that the symplectic group operating on the standard representation has the zero vector as one orbit and non-zero vector as another orbit, only two orbits. And that says that the representation of this group that we are obtaining must be of a very simple kind. It may come from the trivial character, then we are done, or it may come from a non-trivial character. But if it comes from the non-trivial character, then that non-trivial character could be assumed to be non-trivial only on these two entries. Meaning that they are supposed to be trivial on these entries because, you know, you are free to choose the non-trivial character as you wish. And because this representation has a H fixed vector, you will have H psi fixed vector in that eigen component, psi eigen. So this allows one to get an inductive argument that although this entry is still not under our control, you see, if it was trivial character, we would be done. If it is non-trivial, then it is non-trivial only at this place and this place. At other places, it can be assumed to be trivial. But then we do an inductive argument in which we somehow use the fact that we have a trivial character on this entry and all these entries, and we build up, so to say, a similar grid of symplectic groups. And finally, we come to SP2, which is same thing as SL2. And for that, the theorem, so to say, is obvious that a cuspidal representation cannot have a symplectic model, because in the case of SL2, to have a symplectic model means it is trivial representation, then it cannot be cuspidal. And then you get a trivial character there, and somehow this allows one to construct this parabolic. You see, inside GL2N, there is a NN parabolic whose unipotent radical consists of matrices which are of this kind. So recall that the characters that we have constructed along the way are non-trivial only at the very end of the entry. So they don't touch this NN unipotent radical. So this allows one to conclude. So maybe I am already over time. Sorry. Yes. Yeah? No, there is no analog of Klajko for unitary groups. But I guess, maybe the disjointness theorem in some ways is true. I think what is not true is that it covers everything. It certainly doesn't cover everything.
More questions?
Yeah, it's no, there are people, of course, who study exceptional groups a lot. As I said, this Whittaker model is a concept which is all pervasive, so that is certainly there. But other models along the way of Klajko model, there are things called degenerate Whittaker model which are studied in generality. So they are also there. I think there is nothing so beautiful. But I'm not suggesting that it's not studied. Almost anything that one can ask in this direction has been put to a lot of use. I think the general subject of Fourier coefficients, so this is related to Fourier coefficients. And Fourier coefficients has been studied by some. Starting with old guards like Petrsky, Shapiro, many very, very young people. Fourier coefficients on exceptional groups.
Yeah. Are there more questions? Maybe I have one?
Sure.
So first of all, the name Klingen parabolic, is it used in the theory of PID groups and
yeah,
D groups?
Is, I think Klingen parabolic was maybe first defined for SP4.
Okay. SP4. So, and Klingen, who is this?
Klingen is, I think, one can look at math genealogy. He may have been a student of Jigel.
Okay, because
he's a German.
Yeah, okay. So, I had a professor. He was called Helmut Klingen.
Yes.
I was wondering, it's him. Yeah. So, wow. I meet him again.
Wow.
Yeah, yeah, German. German, yeah, in Freiburg, he was my...
Yeah,
Klingen
parabolic, he was one of the people who studied Jigel forms.
Yeah, I attended, okay.
The general subject, there are two parabolics which are known to everybody. Jigal parabolic and Klingen.
Klingen parabolic, yeah, because I have also studied the Klingen parabolic, but not knowing that it was called Klingen parabolic, because in finite groups it's not called Klingen parabolic.
Klingen.
Yeah, yeah, I know. Yeah, but he was really, I mean, I remember his lectures. I mean, he was using two hands.
Two hands.
Uh-huh. One to write and one to erase at the same time. And so he did a lot of stuff in his lectures.
He had a book on Jigal modular form.
Yeah, but I attended his lectures in analysis. So it was
right. He was of analyst.
Okay, so yeah, life is short. And I mean, yeah, you it goes in circles, yeah. So I met Helmut Klingen again, yeah. In India. Isn't that curious? Okay, I think more anecdotes at other talks, maybe. So thank you very much again.